You were just talking about the Westerners just now, right? And I am a convert or revert in your words. And before I converted, I had a very bad picture about Islam. I mean, I sorry to say, but I hated Islam. And the reason was because, like you said, because of the Muslims that I had dealt with. I mean, I feel that since we are talking about how to, you know, do the da'wah to non-Muslims, it's very difficult even for me to even talk to my family because of the picture that we portray to them. I think that it's, if you're talking about Islam itself, okay, fine, it's very, very good religion. It is the only true religion. But don't you think it's wrong to always criticize other religions? I mean, that approach is like really wrong. I mean, we criticize Westerners so much. We do that. I mean, whatever you said about rapes and all those things, it occurs in Muslim countries, I mean, Middle Eastern countries. It might not be reported that much, but it goes on. So why do we always pick on them? And the other thing is that about women, you were saying that non-Muslims say that Islam subjugates women. Because there are so many things in the Quran that, you know, refers to males and females, but somehow whatever that refers to males is just ignored, and everything that, you know, refers to females is pressed so hard, like you were just saying, that virtuous husband and wife. But no, I mean, I've only heard it when I've read all the books. It's like you're supposed to get, you know, virtuous wife, and not. I mean, everything is towards to women only. So why do we do that? It's very difficult to convince a non-Muslim because we do that. And one more example is, you know, that I was told that Rasulullah had, you know, like he gave equal hand in helping his wife in housework and all those things. But why do we only have books on how to be a good wife? Why don't we ever have lectures or anything on how to be a good husband? You know, like nothing, everything is only pressed on women. Women are supposed to be doing this, doing that. That's not what the religion says. So maybe that's the reason why we are putting off non-Muslims.
Sister, that's a very good question. Very relevant. She said that, alhamdulillah, she's a revert. I'd like to congratulate her. Alhamdulillah. And she said that she had a very wrong picture of Muslims before, and I did say in my talk that many people, when they look at Muslims, they would never like to become a Muslim. I said that in my talk. Alhamdulillah, Allah gave her hidayat and she accepted Islam. And she said that the talk was based on how to talk to the West. The talk was why the West is coming to Islam. It wasn't based on how to dawah to West. I've got other cassette dealing with that. I've got a cassette on misconception about Islam. How specifically to do dawah amongst the West is a different technique. Today my talk was not how to dawah. It was the reason why West is accepting Islam, and I'm calling a spade. And you said, sister, very rightly that you should not criticize other religion. Quran says that in Surah An'am chapter 6 verse 108. Revile not those whom they worship God besides Allah, lest in the ignorance they will revile Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the Quran also says in Surah Isra chapter number 17, verse number 81 and 82, وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقْ وَزَعَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ ذَهُكَ. When truth is held against falsehood, falsehood perishes. For its nature, falsehood is bound to perish. You said that I was criticizing the Western world and talking about the X, Y, Z. Sister, criticizing means actually what I would say that without any proof. What I was quoting is statistics of America. So if Americans want to criticize America, and if I'm quoting them, then why are you blaming me? Criticizing means what? You know, actually what I would say, that picking up points and twisting them, like the Westerners do. I'm sorry, I'm blaming them again, but that's a fact. I have to call a spade, and the Westerners love calling a spade, and they are proud to call a spade. They say, no, we are bold, we are truthful. Alhamdulillah, even I am truthful. It may not go down their throat, that's a different thing. They showed in the media the women are subjugated, etc., and I've given a talk on that to clarify. So sister, what I was doing, I was quoting FBI report, written not by Muslims, by the Westerners, quoting statistics of rape, not by Muslims, by non-Muslim Westerners, about adultery, about incest. I'm only quoting their statistics. And when I quote to them, they cannot say Zakir is criticizing, because you know why? I'm quoting from their statistics. If I say, ha, Mr. Ahmad Ali said this, so they say, okay, this man is pulling a fast one. I'm not quoting Ahmad Ali or Sultan Bhai, I'm quoting their statistics. So therefore, I'm using my hikmah system. And besides the saying that even rape takes place in other countries, it's not reported. Sister, I would have to disagree with you. Rape takes more in the Western country. It's not reported there. You know, it is so common. Rape is so common, it's not worth reporting. I've been to West, hardly I read any cases of rape. It is so common, it's a day-to-day life. It's not reported, sister. If it's reported in news brief, if a rape takes place in other countries, headlines. It does take, not that it doesn't take place. It takes place throughout the world. Least rape is there. You're talking Muslim countries, it does take. Those Muslim countries we do not follow the Islamic law, it takes place. So the least rate of rape is in which country, sister? Which country? Least rape in the world. It's in Saudi Arabia. Least rape. It may be taking place there also. I'm not saying it is nil. There are black sheep in the community throughout the world. But the least rate of rape in any country in the world, it's in Saudi Arabia. The least rate of robbery in any country in the world, it's in Saudi Arabia. Yes, there may be other Muslim countries who don't follow Islam. So they are pseudo-Muslims. Regarding reporting, if it takes place in other countries, that comes in headlines because rape is something which is a stigma. In America, it's a lifestyle. Like as the doctor said, a patient comes, I have a VD, doctor says, and I have. So nothing great. They are shameless. According to me, they are shameless. According to them, it's fine. So sister, when I'm calling a spade, I have to call it. I use the best word, public property, but that's a fact. So people may say, I criticize, but I have to call a spade. And that's the reason the Westerners like it. Alhamdulillah. So regarding your first thing that I'm criticizing them, I'm quoting the statistics. Like for example, Quran says, invite all to the way of the Lord with wisdom and with preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. Beloved Prophet said to the Christians, "Wala taqulu salasa." Quran says that when you tell a Christian, do not say Trinity. They say, "Stop it! It's better for you." Even if you say it in the best form, he's bound to feel hurt. See, when you take out the faults of a person, the best way you say, he's bound to feel hurt. And I tell a Christian, why do you worship Jesus Christ? Even if I say with love and care, he's bound to feel hurt. So I have to say in the best way, which is acceptable, but he's bound to feel hurt. Not that I'm going out of the way to insult them. I'm giving the statistics. That was regarding your second part. Regarding a third part, that why do Muslim scholars and speakers speak about women, only picking up verses of the women and not talking about what rights men have to do? Sister, I think you should see my cassette. Women's Rights in Islam. And after I give that talk, people say, when are you going to give a talk, Men's Rights in Islam? And in that cassette, I say what the husband should do to the wife. And even today, if you heard me, when I talked about hijab, I made the same statement which you made. That normally Muslim speakers, they speak about hijab for the woman, but Allah speaks first of the hijab for the man. So why the other people do that, you have to go and ask them. I cannot answer on their behalf. So if you want to see a neutral approach, alhamdulillah, of Islam, you can hear my video cassettes, and there you'll find, even in my women's rights in Islam, I've spoken how a husband should behave to the wife. More of that. Educating even the men, and many men, they don't like it, and they say, now when will you give a talk on men's rights in Islam? So sister, I've given talks. Alhamdulillah, Islam believes in equality between men and women. But equality doesn't mean identicality. Men and women are equal, but they aren't identical. And if you hear my talk, I've spoken about spiritual rights of the women, of social rights, I've spoken about economic rights, about legal rights, about political rights, about educational rights, alhamdulillah, and try to explain that alhamdulillah, Islam believes in equality between men and women. Equality doesn't mean identicality. If you compare to the Western world, again, giving statistics, quoting what they believe, the Western talk of women's liberalization is nothing but a disguised form of exploitation of a body, degradation of honor, and depriving a soul. The Western society, claiming to uplift the woman, have actually degraded her to a status of concubine, of mistresses, of society butterflies, which are mere tools in the hands of pleasure seekers and sex marketeers, which are hidden behind the colorful screen of art and culture. The Western world, claiming to uplift the woman, have actually degraded her. It talks about, oh, we want to uplift the woman, etc. What are they doing? Surely many of you may have gone to the Western world. It's only in the name of art and culture. It's a colorful screen. But behind them, you know what's happening. They want to change the role. Not a man can do this, but a woman can do this. Men and women are equal, but they aren't identical. Men and women are different in physiology. They're different biologically. Well, everything the man does, the woman cannot do. Everything the woman does, the man cannot do. Tomorrow we cannot say, okay, even I want to give birth to a child, I cannot give. I'm different. And do you know in Islam, the status, I'll just quote a couple of examples, I've given my talk. In Islam, where love is concerned, and companionship for the parents, our beloved Prophet said in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 8, in the book of Adab, chapter number 2, hadith number 2, once a person came to the Prophet and said, who deserves the maximum love and companionship in this world? The Prophet said, your mother. The man asked, who next? The Prophet said, your mother. The man asked, after that who? The Prophet said, for the third time, your mother. The man asked, after that who? The fourth time the Prophet said, your father. That means 75% of love and companionship, 3/4 of the love and companionship goes to the mother. The remaining 25%, 1/4 of love and companionship goes to the father. In short, mother gets a gold medal. Mother gets a silver medal. She also gets the bronze medal. The father has to be satisfied with a mere consolation prize. See, these are the teachings of Islam. This is what a Prophet taught us. I cannot say, oh, mother gets so much respect, so I also want to give birth to a child. I can't. So men and women, as I said, are overall equal, but they aren't identical. For example, if in a classroom, there are two students, A and B, both of them get 80 out of 100, both come out first. But if you analyze the question paper has got 10 questions, each carrying 10 marks. In answer to question number 1, student A gets 9 out of 10. So student A is 9 out of 10, and student B gets 7 out of 10. So in question 1, A has a degree of advantage than student B. In question 2, B gets 9 out of 10, A gets 7 out of 10. So in question 2, B has a degree of advantage. In the remaining 8 questions, both get 8 out of 10. So overall, if you add up, both get 80 out of 100. Both are equal. But in question number 1, A has a degree of advantage than B. In question 2, B has a degree of advantage than A. So men and women are equal, but they're identical. Suppose a robber comes into my house, comes to rob. I cannot say, I believe in women's lib. I believe in equality in women. I won't tell my wife or my sister to go and fight. See, what Allah says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 34-35, that Allah has given more strength to the men. So men have a degree of advantage when it comes to physical strength. So it's he who should protect the women. So in strength, men have a degree of advantage. As I give another example, in companionship, the mother gets more respect than father. So in some aspects, men have a degree of advantage. In some aspect, women have a degree of advantage. Overall, men and women are equal. As you rightly said, sister, if you read the teaching of Islam, they are, alhamdulillah, very good. Don't judge Islam by the followers. If you want to judge by what our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. So what you should do, sister, if you said that there aren't Islamic books, etc., talking about what husbands should do, etc., inshallah, you do research and you give talks. Alhamdulillah, I mean, inshallah, Allah will help you. And you'll be more effective because you being a revert. And when a revert speaks, it has more effect. Alhamdulillah. So the thing is that, sister, I do agree there are black sheep in the community. What we should do, we should pick up the good points. And we have even good people, alhamdulillah. Overall, more of them are good than bad. We have to set exemplary of the good people. And the best example is the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And inshallah, for a more neutral view, as you said that people, the speakers will talk about women should do this, women should do that. I'd request you, watch my cassette, and then inshallah, you will change. Hope that's it.